Good evening. The coronavirus is the biggest threat this country has faced for decades.
We have a real threat now to our country, to our, the ability of our NHS to manage it. But we have an opportunity, as I've said, to get on top of it, to make sure that we turn the tide.
From this evening, I must give the British people a very simple instruction. You must stay at home.
My name is Gabs, and I'm a beer guy based in London, and I go to pubs a lot. Pubs are facing their worst ever crisis since March 2020, when lockdown forced closure. In this show, we will offer a unique insight on London pubs, trying to understand how much this culture is at risk. We will ask the masterminds behind the capital's beer industry how they are turning the tide for the future of this British heritage. The pub is a serious thing. In this episode, we will be talking with the management from some iconic pubs in the northeast of London and the chief executive of the British Beer and Pub Association, Emma McLarkin. Pubs are now open with many difficulties to stay afloat. Breweries are facing their own crisis and customers are developing a different drinking habit. Is this the death of the British boozer as we know it? We will find out. Brewdog was established by James Walt and Martin Dickey in Scotland, 2007. The brewery has grown rapidly. They're now one of the most recognisable craft beer brands on the planet. Everyone knows their Punk IPA. With this beer, I started my craft beer journey, and millions of other people too. As they say, it's a post-modern classic. Brewdog Dalston, in the heart of Stoke Newington, is the first fully vegan Brewdog bar, and the offer is perfect for Dalston. Epic vegan junk food, alongside 24 taps of craft beer. Everything all carbon negative.
So, welcome to Brewdog Dalston. This is incredible because I feel like almost I have like an eye into, you know, preparation, work in progress time where not many people are lucky to be, you know, part of. And even if I'm not working here, of course, but I see things moving quick.
It's actually very similar. If you were here in early March of 2019, just before we opened this Brewdog bar, this is a very similar scene and a very similar feeling. It's just a lot cleaner now, because before you open a pub for the first time, it's never clean. But it's the same kind of anticipation, the same kind of excitement and stress and worry, but also like real drive and determination to reopen the bar as if we're opening for the first time ever.
Sure.
And create like a unique offering, a great experience for people, and an incredible kind of hospitality journey as well. There was the worry, of course, like as soon as you close the doors of your pub, there's no revenue to support the staff, to support the business. So it was a mixture of like slight relief and then a lot of worry. But I knew that we would have a plan in place. And I think from the first night, our operations team were traveling around all the bars, making sure everyone was closing properly, cleaning everything, cleaning all the beer lines, all that kind of stuff. And from the next day, they were planning to reopen.
You were starting to discuss with all the managers around the area, and I'm sure within Brewdog, try to understand what to do. I'm pretty sure, right?
So there was a lot of asking advice from other people, and I don't think anyone really knew because, again, I don't like the term unprecedented because it's been used so many times, but it really is unprecedented. So a lot of the bar managers around London, we were all asking each other, like, what do you think we should do here? What do you think about this? And there was a lot of,
who knows?
Yeah, I was going to ask you the same question. So, definitely a lot of really talented operators and talented bar managers kind of thrown off because for the first time we were like, we really don't know what to do here.
I feel very lucky to visit a pub before a big reopening like the one that, you know, pubs are going to have very soon. And I didn't know what to expect. I mean, I knew your standards and I was sure that I was going into our immaculate pub, but this is above that. There is not single smell and everything is pretty clean. No matter all the stuff that you have around, seriously, I can't see a fly.
So we have our own specific, just for Brewdog plan that we put in place. we've had a lot of Zoom calls over the last week, going through it and talking about different things and do we have to change this? How should we approach that problem? So it was kind of put together as a brief from our retail director and from our area managers. And then we looked at it in a call and kind of took it apart and applied it to our own bars. Because while BrewDog is one chain of pubs, each bar has its own kind of personality and its own little quirks and its own identity. So trying to apply those guidelines onto your bar is really the challenge of the week ahead.
Did you receive like worried from your team, like someone on social media, like on WhatsApp groups and stuff saying, how are we gonna do all of this?
I think it would be more strange if the team weren't worried and weren't stressed. How it's not gonna be easy for the team, but definitely very invested in making sure that everyone not only feels safe in reopening the bar, but also feels excited about it. Because as you said, it's about welcoming people back. It's not about letting people in, but they have to play by the rules. It's like, we've put the rules in place to look after you, because we want to invite you back into our pub. And I really can't wait to like serve that person the first pint of beer in a glass in a pub after 3 months, because I think it's going to be emotional for both of us.
We are here to not just encouraging people to don't lose their pub habits,
yeah,
but we want to encourage to explore even more from,
yeah,
from different point of views. So let's say, what is the worst scenario?
People don't feel encouraged or safe to go back to their pubs, and that the current culture of kind of home drinking and ordering a big case of beer from a brewery and sitting at home and drinking a case of beer from that brewery all week, for that to continue would be kind of a nail in the coffin for the British hospitality and pub industry. So I think that's about as bad as it could get. I don't think it's going to happen. British people love their pubs.
Yeah.
I love pubs. And it was kind of the one thing I was thinking about when I was in lockdown, was getting back into a bar with a couple of friends at a distance and enjoying a kind of draft beer. So I'm confident that it won't happen, but yeah, people kind of choosing to stay at home instead of going out would be pretty detrimental for our business.
To answer all these questions and doubts about the future of the beer and pub industry, we've reached out to the chief executive of the British Beer and Pub Association, Emma McClarkin. She leads the organisation as it champions the issue that matter to this industry.
Welcome, Emma.
Thank you, Gabriele.
My pleasure to have you here. And it's very, very simple. The best question to crack on with it should be exactly. Can you give me like an introduction for the British Beer and Pub Association, please?
Well, the British Beer and Pub Association represents over 90% of the brewers in the UK and over 20,000 pubs, so nearly half the pubs as well. So it is a very busy job, particularly during the pandemic right now, but one that I really love. I'm a huge beer and pub lover. And so being able to defend such a British institution right now is a real privilege and honour.
Fantastic. And the first question, especially if we will have a bit more like an international audience, hopefully with this documentary, would be, why are you using the word protect? What do these industries should be protected from?
Well, the British beer and pub sector employs just under 1 million people in the UK, and we contribute hugely, £23 billion. Pounds to the economy. So we're a huge economic player, but as the world knows, we have a huge beer reputation, and our pub is part of our culture. And the top five things people want to do when they come to the UK is to visit a British pub and have a British pint of beer. And we want to protect that. We want to make sure that those pubs are still there, offering that warm, welcoming experience and that fantastic beer. And so that is my job in the pandemic and all the time, to ensure that we have a thriving brewing and pub sector.
Open since 1866 with the name Three Jolly Butchers, this iconic pub sits at the top of Stoke Newington High Street. The Jolly Butchers is an independently run free house with a top choice of ales, beers and ciders. In 2011, the pub was voted amongst the best 10 pubs in Britain. The Jolly's decor is minimal and lets the building's natural space and light speak for itself. The open plan setup adds to the friendly and convivial atmosphere. They have a great Indian restaurant within the pub, provided by the wonderful Boomer Kitchen. The Jolly has helped to make Stokey cool.
Of course, you have the choice to reopen or not. And I don't know the percentages and the numbers of people who decide to go for it and don't go for it from the 4th of July.
Yeah.
Can you remind me if you decide to open just slightly later? Then,
so right? Even the 14th of July.
Why is that?
I spoke to my office manager about it and we weren't sure how trade was going to be here. So we thought it might be better to open the other pubs in the company first. There's a couple of others in the area, see how they went and then proceed from there. Which actually really helped. It helped with expectations.
I'm glad to hear that. And I think it was a very smart move. Mm. On the pub I was around, it was a bit scary.
Yeah, it gave me a chance to go and do some research as well. And like, I actually live in Camberwell. It's a bit of a commute, but it gave me a chance to go in pubs that I live near and see how they're doing things and see how we can match what they're doing and also do things that we can do better.
Fred, you've been so far very positive, and I'm not used to it because the managers that I met so far gave me some sort of level of anxiety and disappointment, which I don't ask, don't make me wrong, but I'm saying I'm glad to see this attitude. But is there anything
what
we do right now?
I had such a long break and such a long time to think about it. And I've been doing this for about 4 years now, not here, not here before. And it was the longest break I've had from doing it. And it gave me time, one, to miss it, and two, to think about what I can do better.
Yeah.
One of which is be more positive and to bring that attitude into here and to share that with the staff. I think it's been a week so far, I think it's going quite well. I mean, there are things, of course, I'm anxious about in future if we don't meet the right amount of trade, then maybe we'll have to let people go. That's something I am worried about. But in terms of being back, I'm not positive.
I don't want to say that Camberwell is massively different from Stockhillington, but there are elements of difference.
Yeah, definitely.
The East London vibe that is around here, the fact that despite what happened, I will spend my night out. Do you see is this spirit still in the area, or people are not ready yet?
It has been a bit quieter in the area in general. So yeah, maybe people aren't quite ready to resume previous levels of outside of joint.
You're an area where the people leave. People stay here. People
yeah.
love to hang out in Stop New Internet and all the surrounded areas. Probably people are gonna walk to here.
Yeah.
So
I saw an article the other day, Stoke Newington, where hipsters go to grow up. Did you see that?
No.
That was the headline.
Did you receive any help from your landlords? Something that they haven't asked you yet?
Okay. Yeah, we had a slight rent reduction.
That's good to hear.
Yeah.
Not everyone had it, so I'm glad to hear that.
But I mean, it's a desirable area to run a business in. So with that comes high costs, and hopefully we'll be able to cover those and stay alive.
Well, that's what we're doing here, because we want to show everyone and Jolly is pleased.
Yeah, well, I mean, all we can do is work hard to make it a really nice place to come, and then hopefully if the public can support us, you know, not grudgingly, you know, not just here to save it, here because they want to be here, then that's the ideal situation.
What happened actually in the early 2020, as we know, you mentioned the pandemic, you mentioned COVID-19. What is the situation? What is the situation right now, basically?
Well, I took up this role as the chief executive of the British Beer and Pub Association in November 2019. Back then, Brexit was the biggest thing on the horizon. But then come March, and we see the pandemic, and it's had an absolutely devastating effect on the beer and the pub sector. And so the switching up of priorities absolutely has taken place, although we don't take our eye off the ball. But yeah, it's meant that we've been in full crisis management as an industry since the doors were closed on the 20th of March. And we have been in crisis management and lobbying hard at government to make sure that as an industry, our voice is not lost during this pandemic.
I like that. That's brilliant. That's fantastic. I'm so glad there is someone like you that can really, you know, understand this, because this is crucial. I'm a camera member, I'm working for a craft brewery, and I'm going to mainstream bars. You know, I don't mind.
And that's fine. And you shouldn't be beaten up or pigeonholed. And I really believe when people say to me, oh, I don't like beer, I don't drink it, I said, when's the last time you did? Go out there and taste the fantastic beers that we have, and maybe try some of the ones that you thought were too old man. They might surprise you too, and that actually they're lovely and fresh and completely unique in their own right. So, you know, don't pigeonhole yourself as a beer drinker. Don't pigeonhole yourself as a non-beer drinker, and look afresh. And particularly when you're going to some of our new breweries and their tap rooms, where you can really taste those different offers that are out there and find out what suits your palate. And that is a whole industry that sits behind that, and one that we need to nurture in the UK and be very, very proud of.
Established in January 2019, the Red Hand is a bar determined to serve the best selection of beers. In many ways, the pub has a very New York feel. It's reminiscent of good bars in Brooklyn. The space is beautiful, with a practical, chic decor, opened by the Graceland Group team. The first thing you will notice in the space is the giant menu above the bar, boasting 17 drafts and a variety of 40 high-quality bottles. This includes beers from the US and Belgium too. If you like good beer, you need to know the Red Hand on Stock Newington High Street.
Hello, Matt. How are you doing?
Yeah, good, thanks.
Thank you very much to find the time for have a chat with us. How are you?
Yeah, pretty good. I'm a bit tired. It's been a long couple of weeks. Getting ready and then remembering how to do everything.
So what do you think should happen to try to, you know, change this situation, which definitely can harm not just you, but so many other pubs in London and the rest of the country? What should happen? Who should raise the voice and try to make a difference?
Well, I think it needs to be government-led. The government needs to force landlords to do a rent reduction and easier access to credit. That's another thing that we struggled with, is finding loans. So it was meant to be easy to get loans. The government said, like, all banks should give loans to companies that are struggling. But the reality is very different. NatWest, the bank we use, went to them for one of these government-backed loans, and they refused and said, sorry, we're not giving loans out to this kind of industry. What? We're surely like the most vulnerable, one of the most vulnerable industries in this whole thing, and so this is what the whole point of the government backed loans were for.
Exactly.
And they said, sorry, we're not prepared to take that level of risk. See you later. In the end, we managed to find a different provider with a government backed loan, considerably smaller loan than we needed, really, and with very high rates of interest, which we don't have to pay immediately. We don't have to pay within the first year, but when the interest kicks in, it's going to be quite a burden. So we need to make sure that in a year's time we've got the right trading capacity to, you know, we don't know what's going to be like in a year's time. Right?
Yeah.
Before lockdown, you know, we're doing pretty well. We're very busy. We seem very busy. And this is always the thing that people like the late person, I used to think before I worked in pubs, it's like, a pub's always really busy and it's great, I love it, and everything's great, so they must be making loads of money, right? But the fact is that we were only just getting by, we're only just scraping a tiniest amount of profit every month. Essentially, these kind of independent pubs usually aren't in it for money. Maybe you can make a little bit, but it's about, it's a lifestyle, it's a passion, and it's a community, which, you know, is one of the reasons why we're open again. Last weekend we were open place. The customer experience was actually pretty good. Everyone had a great time, but we were pretty stressed getting used to things. This weekend was smoother, but it's a lot more work doing full table service in a bar that's designed to, you know, for everyone to congregate around the bar.
It's a good sign, it means you're doing well, it means that, you know, all of your efforts will pay back probably sooner than what we're expecting. And if there is a way, then people can come into a good way to come and support the Red Hands, this is your stage, feel free.
That's what we need, customers coming back. And if, but I don't want customers coming back if they don't feel comfortable, if they're worried about infections. We're all like working through this one step at a time. It's like, we have to start operating to get some money back in somehow. But this is the problem. It's like, it's not an easy, it's not like an easy thing, just come to the pub, because there's this life-threatening illness everywhere, right? So, I don't know, support us if you can. We're going to be doing a web shop as well for some like special bottles that we've got. So, and we're still doing takeaways, as we were doing 30% off draft.
Should we be positive about the short-term future of our money industry? What do you think?
I think there's a lot of things to be depressed about right now. And, you know, as a manager, rather than the owner of the business, like, I don't, I'm kind of insulated from a lot of the stresses of trying to keep the company alive, which is, you know, an expression in the sense that I don't really know what's going on all the time, or have only an idea of it, but I'm safe from that stress. So, in a way, for me and the staff here working day to day, it feels kind of positive, because hospitality is a very positive industry. It's like, it's all about making people happy and like serving people. So there's two different streams going on there, but yeah, we have to be hopeful.
If we will sit again in 2 months' time and having this type of conversation again, do you think there are different scenarios out there that we can you know, think of? Maybe a very positive one, maybe a very negative one. We should go just for a very realistic and in the face one. And if yes, which one of the two, and how would you look like this scenario in your opinion?
I'd be very, very honest with you. If we're having a good day, we'll see that we will lose 5% in terms of our demand and maybe 5% of our pubs in the UK. In the medium to long term, that could move to 15%, and worst case scenario could be 20% lost, or even more perhaps in the UK. We have to be realistic. This is a crisis that the industry has never seen. It's going to take a long time for us to rebuild back up to anywhere near normal trading levels. Remember, whilst we have safety measures, we're already operating at reduced capacity, which even slows down again our ability to rebuild. So it's going to be a long journey, and reopening is the first step in that long journey. But we will be here as the British Beer and Pub Association to support the sector, make sure that as many of those jobs can be held in place, as many of those pubs can stay open, and that we can keep great British businesses surviving.
The fact is, this industry has to change. But for how long? In these unsure times, it is good to see pubs fighting to remain open. In these next episodes, we will be covering other areas of London with an insight to your local drinking culture. Here are some encouraging words from Emma McLaughlin.
Well, what I really hope from this crisis that people take away is just how important their local is. They may have visited it once a week. They may have only visited it once in a blue moon. But when they can't go there, they recognize not only the economic value as to their communities, but the social value, that it is that place where they can meet, they can connect with their community, that there is so much more than just the economics and the money. There is that value that is given to their society from having that place in the local pub. So I deeply urge everybody to go out and support your locals. Yes, life is going to be different. It is in every aspect. But what better place to find out what the new norm and our new life is going to be like than at your local pub?
Thank you for watching Turning the Tide, a What's in the Glass production. Don't forget to subscribe. If you have any questions, email us at whatsintheglassuk@gmail.com. We would love to hear from you. See you down the pub!